Hachette Audio presents How We Show Up, Reclaiming Family, Friendship, and Community. Written and read by me, Mia Birdsong. For Stella and Solomon. For all our descendants. Without community, there is no liberation. Audre Lorde. Author's note. Names. Our stories of family and relationships are deeply layered. They are sources of love, care, and inspiration. They are also sources of pain, trauma, and rejection. They are intimate, personal, and revealing. People's willingness to share their stories with me for this book is courageous and humbling. Their openness and truth-telling is the heart of how we show up. Understandably, many of them asked me to keep their identities between us. Some of the names and details of people's lives have been changed. Accuracy. Telling other people's stories, particularly when they are folks whose stories often get mistold or erased, comes with tremendous responsibility. I do my best to do it well, accurately, and with care, knowing that I'm learning along the way. Thank you to the people who have helped me move further along by directly or indirectly educating me. Akaya Said. In late 2018, my mentor, Akaya Winwood, convened a retreat of about 24 women of color to contemplate what she called the new universal, something she and I had started talking about the year before. I had been exploring, and continue to explore, Black women's culture of leadership as an antidote to the damage wrought by the dominance of patriarchy and white supremacy. It's overly binary, Black women versus patriarchy and white supremacy, but was a simple starting point. Akaya expanded it to include women of color more broadly. New Universal is, in part, about redefining what leadership needs to be for us to create a world that is interdependent, generative, and loving. Her invitation was to come together with like-minded, like-hearted sisters who are dreaming of a world that celebrates, understands, and cherishes our wisdom, gathering to create space that is emergent, unstructured, and designed to evoke the best in each of us. Akaya is a master facilitator, brilliant leader, and believer in infinite possibility. She chose each of the women who attended the four-day gathering and applied what she calls a wise fool's structure. No agenda or clear outcomes, but an invitation to embrace a beginner's mind. I picked up my friend Aisha from the San Francisco airport and headed north to Petaluma, where the retreat was taking place. On the way, we both admitted our skepticism about this retreat. It seemed like a lot right before the holidays, when we both had a million things to take care of. But we were looking at it as an opportunity to spend some time with great folks and have extended solitude to check things off our to-do lists. We agreed that the only reason we'd said yes is because we love and trust Akaya, who is renowned for her ability to develop leaders and her commitment to a just global community infused with purpose and delight. Both of us have been supported, shaped, and encouraged to stand more powerfully in our strengths because of her mentorship. Neither of us could give our husbands any explanation for what we were doing, other than when Akaya asks us to do something, we do it. In fact, all Aisha had in her calendar to block out the 4 days was, Akaya said. Of course, we were smart to listen to her. What we experienced was extraordinary. Akaya brought all of us together in the mornings and evenings so we could get to know one another and share whatever was on our mind, punctuated with brief, free-flowing sermons from her. With little guidance other than, don't do anything you do not fucking want to do, we practiced world-making. In the space of 4 days, We created a culture that was safe, curious, joyful, caring, and generous. We decorated cookies and went for long walks. We discussed our wildest dreams and unspoken desires. We laughed a lot. We talked a lot. We cried, sang, and disagreed. We soaked up wisdom, love, and joy in one another's presence. For sure, it was time out of our regular lives, and there was a suspension of the labor and attention daily life requires. The retreat center provided our food and shelter. We did not have to tend to the needs of children or elders or anyone else. There were no threats to our well-being that we needed to defend against or navigate. We didn't spend enough time together or get close enough to have any serious conflict. But with very little effort, we stepped out of the demands and constraints, external and internal, of our modern lives. We dispensed with the constant rushing and linear ordering of hours and days. We stepped away from the sense that everything from time to money to food to space will run out at any second. We let go of the desire to be right, the fight to be seen and heard, the race toward better and more. We lingered. We listened. We inquired. We wondered. Our rhythm was not driving and relentless, but continually transforming and spacious. We had time to enjoy and learn, to rest and reflect, and to offer and receive care and consideration from one another. When I returned home, I felt full and inspired by the people I'd met or reconnected with, and encouraged by what we'd done together. I was also keenly aware of the absence of the world we'd made. It was quite clear to me that if the broader culture was closer to a version of what we'd made, everyone would be better off. Not just women of color, but everyone. And it made me a little heartbroken to be newly aware of what's possible, but absent from the world I regularly live in. For sure, I have bits of it. I have circles of women I gather with regularly. I have taken steps to remove myself from contexts that demand rushing and vying for space to be seen and heard. I am breathing more, challenging my tendency to consume, and encouraging myself to hold abundance in my mind and heart when I'm feeling the panic of scarcity. But I want more of the world we built, one where we feel seen and accepted, where we feel like we have enough of what we need and can ask for what we want, where we love up and lean on each other. I want to bring the culture of the new universal into my life and the lives of my loved ones and ultimately all of us. James Baldwin wrote, "The place in which I'll fit will not exist until I make it." We all seek belonging, and for very few of us, even the most hermetic, is that place completely separate from others. That means it's something we must build together. As a politically radical Black woman and a curious person, I am committed to living the most liberated life I can with those around me. And I'm not interested in having to step out of my daily life to have it, or in creating a separate place in isolation from the rest of the world. That leaves too many people behind. We have to make it where we live. 1. When failure leads us home. The trap of the American dream. A country is only as strong as the people who make it up, and the country turns into what the people want it to become. James Baldwin. The American dream is both an illusion and an aspiration. It is a false promise and real potential. It is a jumble of contradictions. The Founding Fathers wrote powerfully about freedom and self-governance while inhabiting stolen land, enslaving people, and excluding most of the population from participating in that self-governance. Today, America is a place where a Black man can be elected president by by people who would not hesitate to call the cops on a black person picking up trash outside their own home, barbecuing in a park, or napping in a dorm. It's a country where we celebrate the extravagance of the super rich collecting cars they will never drive and buying mansions for their horses, while witnessing whole communities of people living outdoors in tent cities because the cost of housing is unreachably high. While the American dream has never been an option for most members of some communities, queer folks, unmarried adults, black folks, people who grow up poor, just to name a few, it's also overpromised on the satisfaction, contentment, and happiness it delivers to the people who get their piece of it. The people winning at the American dream are some disconnected, unsatisfied, lonely people. The American dream's narrowly defined paths to happiness and success rely on an acceptance of prescribed roles and a lot of accumulation and exhibition. The quintessential self-made man, and it is almost always a man, is self-sufficient, confident, stoic, righteously industrious, performatively heterosexual, and powerful. His success is signified through acquisition, homeownership, marriage, and children, and display of taste and things, craft beer and Courvoisier, Teslas and big trucks, bespoke suits and I don't care CEO hoodies. On the surface, it looks like that idea has evolved some. We have our Beyoncés, Baracks, and Buttigiegs, but that doesn't mean the American dream has become liberated from its origins, or that its promise of freedom is more free. It just means that more of us are permitted entry to the club if we do the double duty of conforming to its standards and continuing to meet the ones set for us. Women must lean in, queer couples must get married, people of color must be master code switchers. The American dream remains defined by whiteness and masculinity, no matter who occupies the role. Our most rewarded and celebrated leaders, even if they are not straight white men, exemplify these standards. And because it is held up as the ideal we should all want to achieve, we've all been socialized to reach for it. Perhaps most damaging, it includes a toxic individualism that creates barriers to deep connection and intimacy. When we are oriented toward doing it ourselves and getting ours, we cut ourselves off from the kinds of relationships that can only be built when we allow ourselves to be open and generous. My work sits at the intersection of race, gender, and class, and has a particular focus on family. My advocacy and activism through organizations like the Economic Security Project, Family Story, and the Family Independence Initiative, and think tanks like the Aspen Institute and New America, point toward reframing our understanding of how we achieve the good life and who we live it with. In order to be able to tell a reimagined story of what should matter when it comes to family in the United States, I have studied and scrutinized our most accepted versions of good and bad families. Family holds a place of honor in the American dream. A good family has some of the status of a successful career, but with the added weight of morality and virtue. By American dream standards, a good family is an insular nuclear family comprising a legally married man and woman raising biological children. This family is self-sufficient and, as such, functions as an independent unit. It's toxic individualism, but in family unit form. Despite adjustments that have made a little room for same-sex partners who conform to a heteronormative standard, black people who can live up to a white standard of respectability, and women who do paid labor in addition to the unpaid labor they already shoulder, the model is basically the same. Any deviation from the model is seen as second best or underachieving. Adoption is something you do after pregnancy doesn't work out. Being a single parent only happens when you can't keep or find a partner. Divorce is failure. A rental is where you live until you've gotten your down payment together. Unmarried couples are asked, "When are you going to get married?" We may understand why a couple does not have children, but somehow being child-free confers a lack of completion of and commitment to family. Married couples without.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.